Hey guys, it's DukeOnRed1 and welcome back to another Minecraft video. Today we're going to be looking at Red Ranger's plot on the Raven.org server. This is his grand architect plot. He had worked a lot on this plot. There is some interiors that aren't finished. However, it's a very, very impressive plot. Lots of neat little details to see. And I'm excited to show you guys through this because there is so much to see, so much to do. And if you guys want to see this for yourself, just do /warp-red on the Raven.org server. And if you want to easily access the Raven server, just go ahead and download the Raven Launcher, which is in the description below. You guys can check it out and it'll be a direct link to the server there. And so go ahead and download that launcher. So let's go ahead and get started and see what there is to see. It's a very temperate climate that we're in, you can tell, and it's more or less the spring or summertime. I'm pretty sure the summertime. Everything's in full bloom, it looks. Like, you got the grapes, you got the apples, you got the carrots. Everything's grown and everything's like that. However, that's something that we don't really take into consideration building on the server. We just kind of put the crops down and just makes it look nice. Some interiors are not finished, unfortunately, so we'll have to put up with that as we go through the plot. And I'm surprised he hasn't come back, because he got Grand Architect not quite a while ago, actually. And I'm surprised he hasn't come back through and finished these interiors. I would have liked to have seen him finish the main interiors, like the interiors to the keeps, and maybe a few more interiors in the town and such, but it is what it is. You can't really complain because it's a beautiful plot. There's a lot of detail in here and there's a lot to see. So we're going to be checking through this, and hopefully this video won't be too long as we explore and see for ourselves the awesome details that Red Ranger has for us to see. So let's go ahead and walk down this way. I don't want to go up that path. We're going to go this way and see what there is to see. It looks like we got a cave here. Little rut in the ground there. I'm not going to go into the cave, but you can imagine there's something dark down there. Imagine there's like maybe a monster den or something. I don't know. It's along a main road. It wouldn't make sense for a monster den down there. Maybe it's an access for the bottom of this well. I'm going to make an educated guess and say that you can get from the bottom of that well up that cave there. So I'm pretty sure that's how that works. So we're gonna go this way. We got a little farming community here. It looks like it's just a bunch of houses together, and then there is an inn over here. I'm gonna go check out this inn real fast. I forget what the name of this inn is. It is the Ye Old Donkey. A little donkey inn. I like that. Nice little name there. And come up this way, got a little place for a horse there, a couple stables over here for the horses. The travelers can come along the road and say, I am tired or I am thirsty, and they would come this way and come check out the inn and rest. Maybe, usually taverns were a place for the locals to come, you know, after a long hard days of work, and come slurp down some mead or beer, whatever they drink in these days, or whatever is popular among the men or the women, who knows, whatever. So we got, oh, I like that. Nice little shield design up there, using a wooden trapdoor, or a trapdoor, and then a carved stone block on an item frame in the back, as you can see. Very cool design. I like that. So this is where all the men, women, most likely not children, but this is where they would all sit and drink. They would socialize, they would hear the stories, maybe a merchant would come through here, and then they would listen to the merchant's stories, because that's really how news spread in these days, is people would travel from abroad, and then they would tell news to the tavern keeper, or maybe some of these people, and then, you know, the story would continue to get more unbelievable as it goes down the chain, because every time someone tells a story from someone else, that story changes a little bit. And so by the time it got here to, you know, pretty far out in the wild, the stories were probably pretty far out, but pretty cool. Interesting, I like that. Very neat little tavern there. I'm guessing it's not an inn because there wasn't really any places to sleep, so it's a tavern. So we're gonna walk through here a little bit. Again, we don't have all the interiors finished, so there's really not too much to see in this area, except just that it's a little farming community. Not a farming community, just a little community. We've got a creek here. I'm going to follow this creek this way and see what there is to see. We've got a little bit of forest this way. There has to be some detail. Yes, there is. Little fishing camp here. All right, so it looks like this is where a fisherman would be along this creep here. No, this creek here. Looks like a little marsh area. Yeah, that's what this is. It's a little marsh area. I imagine there might be some fish in this area. Some roots are tangling into the water here, and they are sucking up that water. All that cool stuff. That sounded weird. So we have an abandoned house here. Looks like someone died. Oh boy. There's a little place to go down. What is this? Red Ranger's head. Some mushrooms. I'm almost kind of scared to be in here. And there's my head. Okay. So apparently I am dead. See? Here. Oh. I'm not sure if you can see me. There we go. That's me. That is Dukan Red One. And that's my head right there. Alright, so we're going to head up this way. We're going to get back up out of this mess down here and go see what else there is to see. Because I'm sure there is a lot to see. Got a little mixture of sunflowers and wheat here. Looks like the crop is still growing. It doesn't look like a very full crop. Seems like there's some maybe some kind of beetle or something eating up all the plants. And it's causing it to be very scattered like this. And I bet it's a very unhappy farmer. Seeing this crop all dead like that. Here we go, we got pumpkins. Now I want to say something about pumpkins. Pumpkins weren't discovered by the Europeans, by the Middle Age kind of themed people until they reached the Americas. At least that's how I think about it, or as I know it. Pumpkins tend to be a very Thanksgiving kind of thing, or even a Halloween kind of thing. Thanksgiving is a very American holiday, and then Halloween is a European foundation holiday. It came from Europe. Halloween was basically a way, because they wanted to scare off spirits and like evil spirits and stuff like that. So they would figure out ways to try to scare them and do weird things and stuff like that. So yeah, that is that. And Thanksgiving is basically being thankful. So here we got a bridge. And seeing that a bridge would be a pretty substantial use of manpower. The road gets really thin here. But anyway, there's a toll booth here. Where if you cross this bridge or you use this, maybe this is the King's Road or the Lord's Road. And it's pretty odd that there's a toll booth here. It's a pretty small bridge. But still, it's a bridge. This is where everyone would have to come through because it's the really only accessible spot to get from point A to point B. But this is a toll booth in order to pay to get from there to the rest of the area. And there would probably be some guards along here to make sure you pay that debt. Old Malbork Logging Camp. So, Old Malbork. Alright, so I originally thought this logging camp was pretty new because there really isn't much cut down. See, there isn't really anything cut down here. There's a few little trees cut down, but as you can see, it's pretty overgrown. But, seeing that we are in a plot environment, it would be pretty difficult to, like, indicate a true logging camp, because it would take up a lot of space, it would look plain, and then people would be complaining, oh, there's no detail over here. But, yeah, so that's probably why Red Ranger did not do much over on this in the logging camp, is because he wanted to make it seem that there's a lot of detail going on. Now this is supposed to be a bear skin, but this is a new texture, biome texture for that block or that metadata, and now it's a hanging body, so that's pretty gruesome. Maybe Old Malbork was angry at one of his employees, and so he hanged him on his shed thing. So yeah, that's that. So yeah, Old Malbork's logging camp, and maybe this is Old Malbork's house here. Nice. Very quaint. Very small. Okay, so we're gonna head up this hill now. Actually, let's head this way. Ooh, this is pretty dark. Little campsite there. And we're actually gonna go ahead and head up to this keep up the hill. That's where I wanna head right there. Leave now. Okay. What does that mean? Why does it say leave now? Leave now. Is there some kind of dark secret over here? Don't know. Leave now. Okay, so I have no idea. So we're gonna head up to this keep now. and see what this is. So this is Ghetto G-Keep made in Albania, which makes no sense. Okay, so we come into the courtyard. This is where the main dealings of this keep would be. The noble of the keep would come out and tell people what to do and all that good stuff. But typically keeps are a sign of nobility, so I imagine that there's that keep up there and this keep down here. Maybe the nobility of these lands are scattered. These are more or less mansions. You see this and it's pretty substantial. It's not like this little tiny house over there where a peasant would live. You peasant! But this is where the lords, not the lords, but like a noble, a minor knight, or I guess a knight. Yeah, a knight would live here. A little stable there, and a war room down here. And then there's no interior throughout the rest of this, which I'm fairly disappointed about. I was really hoping that the interiors to these keeps would be done, but unfortunately they are not, so we just gotta deal with it. Oh well. And something I really want to point out is for roofs, for those of you that don't do this, try to always remember to put rafters and support structure under your roofs and such. I don't like pulling roofs, and Red Ranger really does a good job with supporting his roofs and such, and I really like that. So pretty cool there. Good job, Red Ranger. Let's get out of here. Okay. I like the outside of the keep. Very cool. Very well detailed. He did a good job. Fantastic. Alright, so we're going to keep moving on and see what there is to see. There is a murder pit here. Looks like there's a cow that fell down. Maybe it was a stray cow. There's maybe a cow pasture nearby and decided to walk down this path. And there was this old trap here. And then the cow fell into the trap and was killed. Oh well. Poor cow. Poor, poor cow. And I'm not sure what else there is to see this way. There is something else. So let's go this way. Oh, I like to see this. This is a fallen down tree. A very neat detail you can add into your builds. And hopefully this may inspire you. But this here is, as you can see, a fallen down tree. Maybe the soil got loose here. And then the tree fell down, maybe in some strong winds. And fell over the creek. I really like that. Really cool idea and design. And then we got a little camp here. Seems like there is a... someone was very unlucky and was dragged off this way. And we'll make our way to where it is dragged to. And as you can see, inside a cave where there is quite a few skulls. So I imagine that whatever this creature is that killed them, I'm going to call Beatrice the Bear. Beatrice the Bear, she is a very mean bear, and she's very hungry. And so she eats humans, because humans are tasty. To the bear, of course. Maybe it's a cannibal. Beatrice the cannibal. Anyways, So we got a watchtower here, overgrown. Doesn't seem to be very effective. I mean, you can't really see out of it, so I don't see why there's a watchtower here. It's all overgrown. Maybe, it wouldn't... See... These trees, this tree here would probably be, 50 years old, 40 years old. This watchtower would be crumbled and rotten by then, so this watchtower is pretty recent. Maybe it's a hunter stand. A tree stand, I don't know. Okay, we're going to keep moving on. There's no reason to solve that mystery. Alright, so we're at a blacksmith. Oh, I love this. Ooh, that's sexy. And look, he just, decoration. Maybe that's his brother or something. No, that's supposed to be a bearskin texture again. But again, there's a change of biome textures. And so now we got dead bodies. But we're going to keep moving through here and see what there is to see. I love this blacksmith. Very neat. I like this open area. Nice little place where people can congregate. Or, he can move around, do his stuff. Got a little canoe here. So he can sort of... floaty floaty down the river. And is there any secrets under here? No, there isn't. Okay, so anyway, this is another bridge here. We're gonna keep moving this way. We want to make our way actually up to the other keep up there, the Crow's Nest Keep. That is what it's called. And go see that. So I'm actually gonna go ahead and fly for the most part And we're going to follow this road all the way up to the top and see this keep. I love this keep. I love the palette of it. This is Crow's Watch Keep. Crow's Watch, not Crow's Nest. All right, so here's Crow's Watch Keep. Again, the interior is not finished, unfortunately. Bummer. I would have loved to have seen the interior to this, but it is what it is. I love the darker stone at the bottom, and then you got the brick at the top. Very cool design. Love it to bits. Very neat. And you got, like, it looks like an old garden. Doesn't seem like this is a very used castle anymore. But then you got this little wraparound road here, and it goes down to what looks like a little place where they would put all the gong, aka crap. It would make more sense for this to be over here, because, you know, being at the bottom of the tower, they could just, you know, maybe there'd be a garderobe sticking out, and then people could just crap down into the pit. However, in this case, maybe there's just chamber pots in there, and they would just cart the, or wheelbarrow the crap around to here and put it in. And as you can see, there is a owl here. Maybe he just enjoys the smell, but no, he's probably here for this rat. He's been trying to catch this rat for months, and so he's just peacefully sitting there preparing to eat rat. Tasty. How many of you have tasted rat before? I can tell you I have not. Very unclean creature. So here we have a camp. I'm guessing these are some traveling merchants, because you got some food, some crates. It's like a seat for two, and then you got, you know, a little place around the fire cooking some meat. So you can imagine there'd probably be, you know, a few people here. So some merchants, I imagine, and that's pretty cool. I like that a lot. Very cool. And you got a creek here. Not a creek. A little looks like a drainage ditch, a little pond. Who knows? Pretty cool. I like it. And then we have Daniel Blacksmith. So this heads back to that blacksmith we were actually just at, so we don't need to go back that way. So now we're going to head up this road and up to the town. Oh, before we do that, I want to make a particular note about the detail here. Like, so natural. So nice. I love it. See, the way that you achieve this is, one, you sort of, you variate the textures, you know, add little bits of rock and gravel here, some mossy stone, some gravel where you feel like the rock would sort of chip away, and all that good stuff. This is a big no-no, grass underneath gravel or rock or anything. Also, that's a big no-no, but this doesn't matter, just little, forgotten pieces. Again, there's another piece there. But anyway, what I particularly want to note is all the grass and all the weeds and everything, how it's overgrown. Very, very cool. I love that so much. And it looks like that there would be some water through here, but it looks like that no, there wouldn't be any water go through here. It just looks like a little cleared area. But yeah, you'll notice that there isn't a open grass block. You know, the occasional one here and there, but still, very neat. But yeah, I just wanted to point that out really fast, because I really thought that that is a really neat thing, and hopefully inspiring, because filling up all of the grass blocks is pretty important. And another thing I want to point out is the road is tiny. You can only get one cart through here, but, there is a good excuse for that. This is the plot, and plots are restrictive spaces. And when you are working with a restrictive space, you got to sort of scale things down in order to make more fit. And so that is why these roads are small. However, if you're building on a larger scale build, my sincere suggestion would be to make sure your roads are large, depending on what road it is. Now, if it's a road to a village, this is a pretty, you know, this would be a pretty, you know, pretty good road for a road to a village. Now, if it's a road to a town, which this is, we're going to a town up here. And if it's the main road, in my opinion, I think should be at least twice this size. You know, big enough for two carts to pass by. That would be the most sensible. Now, if it's a long road, like down like a plain or through, or even through a fort, even, you know, still, the road should be pretty thick if it's a main road. If it's used often, it should be pretty large. But, again, working within a plot environment, you gotta work pretty small, because, Yeah, you want to try to fit as much as you can in. So if you're working on a big open world, then that would make sense to make a, you know, big open roads and all that good stuff. Because, you know, getting a cart like this, and say there's another cart coming the other way, there's really no way to pull off, there's no way to get out of the way. You'd just be kind of stuck, and then you have to back up all the way until you get somewhere, like maybe down there, to get out of the way. But, you know, it's just kind of a side thing. It's a plus, in my opinion. If I see someone that does that, you know, makes realistic roads and kind of thinks about how the carts would travel and all that stuff, that would be a plus. It's not a negative if you don't do it. You know, at least Red Ranger tried. He did a good job with making the road at least bigger than, you know, something like this. This would be pretty thin, you know, insubstantial. But being the main road, it should be pretty thick, and it leads right into the town. Welcome to Burmok. Okay, so this is the town of Burmok. And then Hendrick Pigs Farm. Okay, so we got some pigs here. And I like this pigsty. Very particularly like this pigsty. It's very cool. You got the inside here, and it seems pretty cozy for some pigs. A little trough there for them to feed and eat their stuff-ma-juff. And it looks like Hendrick's house up here where they would do their thing. Okay, so another thing that I want to really, I really want to talk about is roads leading off the plot. Some people build their plots in a way that the roads only are inside the plot.
No.
Closed environments, that's good for a plot. However, you want to make it look like the plot continues. Now, Red Ranger does a good job with that. However, I've seen a few plots lately where everything is just inside the plot, and then there's no roads out to the outside, and it just seems very closed in, unrealistic, and it just does, it kind of like takes away from your imagination, because, you know, from a plot like this, you can see that there are roads leading up the plots, and that is a very important thing, because it, you know, you imagine the road continuing, and maybe it opens up somewhere, and there's lots of fields, and, you know, you can just imagine that. Maybe there's a giant forest or something, I don't know. You can just kind of imagine the expansion of this plot and see it in your mind and see what it would look like. So I thought that would be a pretty cool thing to point out, is make sure your plots are accessible from the outside. All right, so we got a little sheep pasture here. I thought this would be a pretty cool thing to show off. But yeah, I really like this. Got a couple sheep around, some places where the sheep have eaten the grass and everything. So yeah, love that. So we're gonna head right back over here to the town, right to where we were, which was right here. All right, so we're entering the town of Burmok, and looks like we have a Radimir Slovak's blacksmith. I really like this a lot. Now, some misconceptions in building on the server. People always think the blacksmiths only build weapons or only make weapons. That is not the case. Blacksmiths were used or were needed for making a whole slew of different things, and, you know, primarily they would be making building things like latches or nails, shovels, tools, hammers, and be pretty expensive at times, because collecting iron, smelting it, and everything of that sort would take a pretty substantial process. Like, depending on the skill level of the blacksmith, usually it would take a pretty long while to make just one thing. However, you know, depending on, you know, the resources that were put into it, you know, it could take a lot, you know, it could be a lot faster, you know, the skill level of the blacksmith. Now, another thing is, now, they would make weapons, depending, again, on the skill level of the blacksmith, but, like, maybe during wartime, then the you know, whoever is paying for the swords and weapons to be mass-produced, the blacksmith would probably be provided with a whole bunch of different apprentices, and then the blacksmith would do, you know, this, and he would tell the apprentice to do that and stuff like that, and then they would mass produce swords, axes, pikes, arrowheads, all that good stuff. All right, so now we are at a recruiting office. Join the Slavic Brothers, be a true hero, join the army today. All right, so I guess the Slavic Brothers are a guild in the army, and then the army would be like the official thing. So I guess this would be the equivalent to the Marines, you know, a very specialized core of the military, and then you would have the, you know, the regular army. So it depends on which kind of level of dedication you want to put into it. So you would walk up, you would get your papers, you would sign up, you would basically tell them your name, you'd sign in the book, where you live, maybe some contacts and such like that, all your information. They would hand you papers, and then you would go to the nearest armory or barracks and such like that, and then you would get armed up and prepared for whatever duty they would have. Most likely they would put you on latrine duty in order, so cleaning the garter robes and such like that. Guy the Rope Maker. I'm not sure if that is a Kingdom of Heaven reference, but Guy de Lusignan was the king of the Crusading army towards the end of the movie, and he was an idiot. Vladimir's. I don't know how you pronounce that. Vladimir's workshop. That's a very interesting way of pronouncing that. We got a little workshop in here. Very cool. Looks like there's a lot of different things. Pots and pans, hammers, pots, knives. Just a lot of different things in order to make whatever this guy makes. Got an anvil there. There's really no clear focus to this workshop. You know, it doesn't really seem like they just make something specific. We come this way. There's some marketplaces around. I love this market. It looks like a general grocery. You got fish, you got cabbage, different foodstuffs and all that. I like it a lot. Very cool. Very, very cool. Love it. And we're just going to walk through here just a little bit more just to see some of the details. Again, the interiors aren't really that finished. There are some interiors that are finished. As you can see, you got a butcher here. Very cool. I like this butcher a lot. Very, very neat. Doesn't seem like there's a cold room. But again, there doesn't need to be a cold room. There should be a cold room, like a basement or something, but it is what it is. Looks pretty cool. I like it. And that is that. So we're going to go ahead and fly up now. I think that will really conclude this video. There's a lot more to see, so if you guys want to come to this plot, just go ahead and do what I suggested earlier. Come to the Raven.org server. Well, first of all, download the Raven.org launcher, which is in the description below. Come join the Raven.org server and do /warp red. And that'll take you right here, and you can check this out for yourself, because there is a lot to see. And if you want to check out more warps on the server, just do /warp arc. And then that will show you a massive list of all kinds of suggested warps and things that you can see all around the server. And maybe it'll inspire you. We are using the Conquest Resource Pack by Monsterfish and all that good stuff. So, yeah. Without any further ado, I have a Facebook and a Twitter for you guys to check out. Go on over there, and I'll try to keep you guys updated on things. I've been a little quiet over there lately, but I will try to keep up with that and make sure you guys feel a part of the community and keep the Conquest community going as much as I can. There's only so much I can do. I only have a small percentage of the, I got a pretty large portion of the Conquest community following this channel, but, I can only do so much, so. But yeah, follow me over there, guys, and I'll try to keep you updated. And I think that's about it. So you guys have a great day or night, wherever you're from. I will see you on the next one. Till then, bye-bye.